Welcome to the Christian House of Prayer's midweek service. Tonight's message comes from the series entitled, Jesus is Our Aiming High, from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb. Tonight's subtitle will be, Confession, Our Focused Faith in the Father versus a Faulty View of God.
From the book of Deuteronomy, we are coming from Deuteronomy chapter 1, and just one verse of scripture, the 8th verse this morning. We're talking about aiming high. Jesus is our aiming high. And we're thankful and grateful to God for that, hallelujah, because it's all about Him. Our aim is Him. Paul talked about pressing towards the mark for the prize of the high calling of God that is in Christ Jesus. And the high calling is sonship, the high calling of God. God is calling us up. He's calling us up. And the way up with God is always down with us, meaning as we humble ourselves under His mighty hand, He lifts us up. God wants to pick you up. God wants to help you up. God wants to cause your head to be lifted up. Hallelujah. And Jesus gives us every reason to have high hopes and to lift our hopes and to keep our heads up high. Aiming high. Jesus is our aiming high. In the book of Hebrews, because where we are this morning in the book of Joshua, Joshua is the Hebrew name for Jesus. Isn't that wonderful? So he's telling us the book of Joshua is a book about him. It's a book about Jesus. And in the book of Hebrews, chapter 12, the writer in the book of Hebrews gives unto us this phrase, looking unto Jesus, who is the author and finisher of our faith. And when it says looking unto Jesus, the illustration or metaphor would be that of a person going or people going to a restaurant to eat. And the waitress or the waiter ask after he's taken our orders, will this be on one check or will it be separate checks? And sometimes it's separate checks. And when it's separate checks, then the eyes of the waiter or waitress, even though it doesn't look like it, but their eyes are on everybody at that table, meaning that they're expecting everybody to pay for their bill. So if somebody walked to that door and they haven't paid for that bill, that waitress or waiter most likely would stop. Excuse me. But if a person says at the table, hey, put it on one check, what does that mean? It means to take your eyes off of everyone else, even though they're ordering. Take your eyes off of them and put your eyes on her or him that promised to pay for it all. And this is what this word looking unto Jesus means. It means take your eyes off of whatever has captured your attention and has brought you out of focusing on God. Take your eyes off of the problems of life. Take your eyes off of the pain. Take your eyes off of the pressure, because in life you will have problems, pain, and pressure. Jesus said that. He says, in this life or in this world, you will have tribulations. Tribulations is three times the trouble. You're going to have problems. How many of us know what problems are all about? You're going to have some problems. Say, I got it. And you're going to have some pain. How many of us have ever experienced pain? Hallelujah. If you have not experienced pain, then you cannot appreciate the pleasure. And so it is painful in this life sometimes. There's pressure, pain, and there are problems that we deal with. But you take your eyes off of that and you focus your eyes on the one who has the power, on the one who gives the promise that he can take care of it all. Somebody shout, hallelujah. So it's not the external pressure, it's the internal power that he's trying to get you to understand that God, hallelujah, can handle every given situation. No matter what it is, there is nothing too hard for God and nothing impossible with God. And our God is not a God too little to fix your problem. And so in the book of Joshua, as we would focus in on God this morning, aiming high. In the 8th verse, it reads, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night." Where are you? Are you in the book of Joshua? I said the book of Joshua. What book did I tell you? I already got a division in this congregation. Listen, people, at the 10:30 hour, you're subject to get anything. I'm somewhere else. It's in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter 1. Look at your neighbor and say, chapter 1. What book is it? Tell him. Go ahead. Now tell him to pay attention to your preacher. Go ahead. Even if he's confused, don't you be. Go ahead. Joshua chapter 1. I say Joshua chapter 1. Why do you think we have these screens up here? Joshua chapter 1, verse 8. See what you done to me, Denasia? "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success." Wow, I never had that much difficulty reading a verse of scripture. Give three people a high five. It can be the same three people. Just tell them it's all about him. Go ahead, it's all about him. It's all about him. Hallelujah. It's all about him. You may have your seats in the presence of our life-changing King. Thank you all for loving me and forgiving me from. It's a good thing I didn't tell you to talk, to open your Bibles to the book of Nehemiah. But Joshua chapter 1, verse 8, he says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of our mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night." And what we've been discussing, and listen to me, I'm very sincere about this. I pray that you're listening to this preacher and that you are hearing what God is saying. I am a voice, as John the Baptist says, one crying in the wilderness. I'm crying to you, and I'm asking you to make sure that you're connecting with every message, line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little, because it's going to give us the big picture. What we are teaching is a series entitled Jesus Aiming High. And whenever you have a series, like on television, they go back and they show you clips, if you would, of the episodes so that you can, in some sense, know from where they came and where they are in terms of where they're wanting to go in this next episode. But if you don't have the clips of the previous episodes, sometimes you just go ahead and flip it because I don't know where they are with this. So it is in the series that we're teaching. I like to give you little clips from the previous episodes so that you can know from where we've come to where we are and where we're headed in this series. In the book of Joshua, chapter 1, the 8th verse, where it talks about meditation. "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate." We've been talking about the mastery of meditation, the mastery of meditation. And it begins with imagination. There are four trees that we have been describing, and we are on the third tree this morning, which is confession. But the mastery of meditation, and the reason why we're calling it the mastery of meditation, because the master is the one that's teaching this, and it is he, the one that have practiced this and showed unto us how meditation works in a believer's life. It was David, a man after God's own heart, that God used to describe what we are preaching. David said in the book of Psalms, "Let the words of my mouth..." This is where we're going to be this morning. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my God and my Redeemer, my strength and my Redeemer. Let the words of my mouth and, in addition, the meditation of my heart. It was David who said in Psalms chapter 1, verse 1, blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sit in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law will he meditate. He used this word, meditate. Will he meditate day and night? In order for Joshua and the children of Israel to take the promised land and to receive the victory that God had for them, they would have to do what God is saying to do in chapter 1, verse 8. This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate when day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein. Then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and thou shalt have good success. The mastery of meditation begins with imagination. Imagination. And we have already established the fact that out of all of God's creation and out of all of God's creatures, you and I, we're the only ones that have an imagination. The only ones. Everything else has a level of knowledge and intelligence in order to even survive. God has built that within every creature and within his creation. But you and I, the Bible says, when God made man, he made us in his image and after his likeness. That's why we're always, progress is important to us. Birds are still making the bird nest the way they made it when they were made, unless man has taught them another way. Why? Because man, listen, you and I, we have an imagination. And our imagination helps us in our identification. God made us in his image after his likeness. And the function of imagination is to imagine. It's to capture God's dream for your life. The Bible says, without a vision, the people perish. And some people, they have no vision for their life. They have no vision. No vision. And if you have no vision for your life, the Bible says, then people perish. So the imagination, write this down. You should already have it. And then I move from here. We have said a whole lot about this. But imagination, it is the ability. It's the divine ability to enlarge your capacity to believe. It's the divine ability to enlarge your capacity to believe, because it's the divine ability to conceive what a thing could be. And God is not saying whatever you imagine, God's going to give you. But at least, in other words, God is telling you, in the world, they say, think out of the box. Well, who put you in the box in the first place? Hello? No, God wants you to be able to use your imagination, because if you can conceive a thing, then you can believe a thing. And a lot of people cannot conceive it, therefore they cannot believe it. Two blind men came to Jesus and said, Lord, can we be healed? And Jesus said, do you believe you can? And they said, yes, Lord. Do you believe I can heal you? Yes, Lord. Then Jesus said, then be it done unto thee according to thy belief, according to your faith. Some people cannot believe something because they cannot conceive something. I cannot conceive being off of wealth. I cannot conceive. If you can just conceive it, then the next step is believe it. Then you can receive it and you can even achieve it. Because the two brothers that was flying the kite, what were their name? Some of you even know their first names. Glory to God for you. But they just imagine man can fly. Imagine man can fly. They just imagined it. I believe I can fly. And it moves us to the next place. That's repetition. So it's from imagination to repetition. Repetition is the ability to become good at it. In other words, to become good at what, Bishop? The idea of life If your aim is anything other than this as its foundation, then you're already out of focus. And that is, the aim is to please God. And how do you know that, Bishop? Because the Bible says that it pleased not God. God says it's not good that man should be alone. And when he made man, man was alone with God. Man was alone. Again, I know this is, I'm repeating myself, but that's what repetition means. It means to repeat. It's the art of learning. And so it is, if you would, when we said before, a man was, somebody say, but he was alone. And people end up saying Adam was alone, and they walk around saying, I'm just so lonely. God gave the elephant a wife, didn't give me one. God gave the lion a wife, didn't give me one. How come I'm lonely? If you are lonely, it's because you're not alone with God. Because you can spell it A and then L-O-N-E. That's the reason why many people are lonely, because they feel I'm alone. But the Bible says, in the next verse of scripture, God says to Joshua, don't be afraid, neither be dismayed. Why? For the Lord thy God is with thee. You're never alone. And what God is trying to get you to be is A-L-L-O-N-E, all one with God. And when you're all one with God, you're never lonely. Hallelujah. If you're all one with God, glory to God, then you're never lonely. You're never lifeless. Some people walk around dragging, sagging, lagging with a bad attitude because why? I'm lonely, and they're lifeless. And you're never lonely and lifeless with God. If you're with God, glory to God. Moses was with God for over 30 days and didn't even know it. It didn't say that he got hungry. You know, when the presence of God, glory to God, when the presence of God is on you, you could order a table full of food. And as you get the talking about God and God comes in the midst of your presence, all of a sudden your appetite disappears and your food gets cold. You move that food away and God is feeding your soul. Somebody need to hear what I'm saying. When you walk with God, glory to God, you have to remind yourself, glory to God, about everybody else around you. And so the repetition, I'm going somewhere, I'm connecting my points. Repetition is repeating. Repetition is the art, say the art, of becoming good at it. Good at what? At aiming to please God. Why don't we become just good at pleasing God? The operative word of pleasing God is faith. And the operative word of faith, this is a synonymous term, is obedience. There is no such thing as faith, and we have not obeyed God. And so the whole concept of becoming good at it, good at what? Good at obeying God. Good at hearing and stepping out and obeying what God says. And you do it through what is considered and called the art of routinizing something. To routinize. Meaning that it's repeating something or routine something or doing something again and again and again. And this is where practice makes perfect. Man, will I ever get to, but this is so good. You know, Wednesday night I said something in terms, I don't even play football, but I know how football is played. And I know this much, that if a person is, let's say, a quarterback, what he has to do is aim at that exit sign. Can you hit that exit sign? And he has to throw that ball and throw that ball until he can keep hitting it and keep hitting it, keep hitting it. Now, he never throws at a moving target. Why? That's stupid, because if the target's moving, if you throw it where the target was, the target is no longer there. So what you do, it's your timing, it is your synchronizing. You throw that ball at a particular place, and it is upon the receiver to run at the place and catch it where you're throwing it. I'm getting no help up in here, but glory to God. Hallelujah. I think I can be a coach. The metaphor is to routinize. Say to routinize. in the metaphor of routinize, it is walking. When you find in the Bible, God says that they walked in the Spirit. What does he mean by that? They walk by faith. What does he mean by that? Walk in love. What does he mean by that? Walk in truth. What does he mean by that? If he walk upright, no good thing will be withheld from him. What does he mean by that? God is talking about his simple plan of your obedience. It's like walking. It's right foot and then left foot. What's next? It's not skip. Now you're skipping. You're no longer walking. No, it's right foot and then left foot. Then what's next? It's right foot, then left foot. What's next? It's right foot, then left foot. And a part of the walking process is falling while you're walking. Man, I feel my afro growing. See, just because a person falls, it doesn't mean you fail. It's a part of the process of walking. What were those brothers' names that gave us flight? I didn't study this out. Now I know I got some deep professors in here with me. I've already proved that I'm not all there. So go ahead and chalk it off, my ignorance. But here's the point. I have not studied this out, but I know when the Wright brothers, when they said, I believe we can fly, and when they attempted to do it, I know they failed. And when they fail, how many people mocked them? I told you couldn't fly. God didn't make you with wings. You can't fly. What you trying to fly for? I know you couldn't fly. Do you think that the first time they attempted, they hit it? No more than the first time that a toddler rocks and reels and steps out the walk and falls. And then for the rest of the toddler's life, that toddler, I ain't gonna try it again. I ain't getting up. That's a part of walking. Get back up. You put the toddler back up and they rocking and they reeling and they take a step. And then they take the second step and mama runs and tells somebody, come and watch him walk. He just took two steps yet. He ain't walking. You gotta hit the third step. That means you're into something now. Glory to God. And so it is with many of us. We attempt to do something and we fail at it. It's a part of walking. It's a part of you walking with God. It's a part of you walking with God. And even though you stumble and even though you fumble, God is able to keep you from falling. And it is he that will present you faultless before his presence with exceeding and with great joy. Somebody give God the praise. He's the one that makes sure you have good success. Hallelujah. Now I said all that to open up the can now for the third, that is, imagination is the ability to conceive what a thing could be. And then we said, repetition is the ability to become good at it. Just keep doing it. But now confession, this is where we are now. So it's imagination, it is repetition, and today I want to just spend a few moments opening up this concept about confession, and then the last would be concentration. Confession. I want to talk to you about confession, which is focus faith. Say that. Faith. In the Father. Five words. Focus faith in the Father. Say it again. Focus faith in the Father. Confession helps you to focus faith in the Father, opposed to a faulty view of God. I'm just going to open this up, because most people have a faulty view of God because they lack focus faith in the Father. The word confession, in this text, he says, this book, and the book is the Bible, this book shall not depart out of your mouth, meaning keep saying, this book, don't stop saying what the book says, what God says, because Confession is the Greek word homologeo. Homo sapien is the same species. Homo means same. Legeo means to speak. Homo legeo. Speak the same thing that God says. And when we do that, it focuses or aligns us in the faith of the Father or of God, opposed to, stay with me now, a faulty view of God. The Bible teaches us that this word confession, out of every religion, you probably never heard this before in terms of religion, but Christianity is called the Great Confession. That's what it's called. Christianity is the Great Confession. You cannot get in the kingdom or you cannot be saved without confession. Write the scripture down. I just want to give it to you. I shared it this morning. In Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. And this is how it reads. They'll have it on the overhead in just a moment. That if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. That's how simple salvation is. Confessing with the mouth and believing in the heart that God raised him from the dead, the question becomes, why did he die? See, all this is a revelation. He died for my sins because I was a sinner. All have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That's Romans chapter 3, verse 23. Then Romans chapter 10, verse 9, that if thou shalt confess or agree with God, Jesus said to Peter and to the other disciples, who do you say that I am? And Peter said, thou art the Christ, a son of the living God. Jesus said, flesh and blood has not revealed it unto thee, but the Father has revealed it unto you, Peter. And he gave him the keys, meaning he entered into the kingdom. He entered into a domain. He entered into a realm that the other disciples still had not gotten into. Because confession is how you get saved. You confess with your mouth. What are you confessing? You're not making something up in your head. You are, listen, you are revealing what God has brought down into your heart. If you would confess, that is, say what God says. Say, as Peter said, you are the Christ. And Jesus said, you didn't get that by education. You didn't get that by information. You got that by revelation. You said what the Father said. You didn't just make that up. It wasn't just something that you thought up. It wasn't just a good idea. The Father birthed it down, and you said what God said. This is why God says to Joshua, this book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth. Keep saying who God is. Keep saying who God says you are. Keep saying what God says he has given unto you. Keep saying what God says you can do and step out and see that God will back you up if you'll do it. Confession. That's Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. Then after you're saved, now I want to say this, and I want you to pay close attention to this, because now that you're saved, Romans 10, verse 9 and 10 is salvation. Verse 10, he says, for with the heart, not the heart that pumps the blood. If you don't have that, you don't live the natural life. But the spiritual heart that pumps the life of God, if you don't have that, you don't have the life of God. He says, for with the heart man believe unto righteousness. With the heart, this is a spiritual law. Please hear me. This is a law in everything that we operate in God's word. This is how it is. With the heart man believe, and with the mouth confession is made. Now you're saved. And God says, the same way you got saved is the same way that I'm going to do everything in your life. Believe it with your heart and confess it. Say the same thing I say with your mouth. Now, the second verse of scripture, and this is where the focus out of faith comes into play. Because in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9 and 10, that's easy to remember for me. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. But then 1 John, that's in the old, excuse me, that's in the back of the Bible. 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. Not the gospel, but 1 John chapter 1, verse 9. He says, now this is how he says it. I want you to see that. I need you to see that. Just turn there. We'll get to where I'm going. But I need you to see this. Romans chapter 10, verse 9 and 10, that's how you get saved. And now that you're saved, 1 John chapter 1, verse 9 and 10. This is for the saved. But now, many times, people have heard this for the sinner. 1 John 1, 9. This is not for the sinner. Are you in 1 John yet? 1 John chapter 1, verse 7, he describes how we get saved, the blood of Jesus. It's right there. He talks about it's the fellowship that we have with God because of Jesus shedding his blood. And then in verse 8, he continues to move us. In the eighth verse, and he uses this word. Now, I don't have time to spend a lot of time here because I'm going somewhere else. But he uses the word S-I-N, sin, which is a description of the nature of the sinner. It's sin. That's the description of the nature of a sinner. Why do you think we were called and we're called sinners? Because sinners, that's like a dog's nature is, you say, man, he acting like a dog. Are you hearing me? He ain't a dog, but he acting like one. A sinner's nature is, whatever the sin is, he gonna sin. That's in verse 8. But now in verse 9, he's no longer talking about sin, but sins. And so he says, and if we what? Confess our sins. Now, here's where a lot of people get in problems, in trouble. And this is where faith becomes out of focus also. Because we tell sinners, you got to confess your sins. And then you get saved. Romans 10, verse 9 and 10. That if thou shalt confess the Lord Jesus and shall believe in thy heart that God has raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Where's the sins? But we tell people, you got to confess your sins to get saved. Friend, I know many of you got that halo right over your head and sanctified, and you came out of your mother's womb with hallelujah. And every step that you've been taking is praise the Lord. Glory to God. I understand. But there are a few people like me that if you tell me to confess my sins to get saved, how long is eternity? Are you crazy telling me to confess my sins? Man, you don't have enough time. Does God have enough time to hear? And furthermore, I can't remember all of them. I can't remember all of now I'm not mocking sin. I'm rejoicing over the fact. Thank God I didn't have to confess all my sins. All I had to confess was that I was a sinner and I need a Savior. I believe in the Savior. And now after I'm saved, he says if we would confess our sins, now he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins. Well, before, when I was a sinner, did God forgive me? Of course he forgave me, but he didn't just forgive me. David, what he did, can I say this? He took the whole, I want to say the whole page and ripped it out. God took the whole page. I'm not reading your notes, but God took the whole page and ripped it out. But then David, he didn't do that. What God did is took, because it was not a page. God took, the Bible says in the book of Revelation, it says that God took the books and he threw the books away. And he says, now there's another book written down and your name is written down. There's another book. You got so much sins. It's not a page. God threw, he threw the book away and you become a new creature in Christ Jesus. Somebody give God a praise. Hallelujah. Woo! Glory to God. See, many of us, I'm on page 100 of my sins, God. I got about 500 more pages to go. Oh, God said, throw that book, give me that book, and throw the whole book away. I'm going to open up a new book of glory for you. I got a book. Now, this is what I mean. So if I'm under the supposition that starting with that, and then all through my life, I'm still just an old sinner, saved by grace. No, you become a new creature. Now, here's the point. Faith and focus, and then we'll pick it back up. Faith, it's a focused faith in the what? Father. Huh? He wants you to know he's a loving, caring, sharing Heavenly Father. Is he God? Yeah, he's God. But when they said, Jesus, teach us to pray. Teach us to pray. And we're going to cover some of this because you need to know the Father. But Jesus didn't say, when you pray, and they knew all these names. When you pray in the beginning, God, Elohim. That's Elohim, the God of creation, restoration, the God that began it all, the God of new things, God. Jesus teaches us to pray. He said, when you pray, you could say, El Elyon. He's the, not just God, but he's the most high God. The possessor of heaven and earth, the deliverer of all of our enemies. He takes you from rags to riches or from riches to rags. He humbled the exalted and he exalt the humble. He could have, Jesus, teach us to pray. He could have said, Elroy, the God that sees and watches over me. He knows what's wrong with me. He makes the crooked things straight and right in me. He could, no. Jesus, teach us to pray. He could have said, he's El Shaddai or El Shaddai, whichever way you want to pronounce it. But he's the God of the good and plenty, the God, the breasted one, the one that makes all grace abound toward you so that you always have an all sufficiency and all. He could have went on that. Jesus, teach us to pray. And you know they knew he's Jehovah. Jehovah, yeah. He's Jehovah, but not just Jehovah. Jehovah is with the compound. Jehovah Jireh, the Lord that supplies. He's Jehovah Nissi, the Lord who is your banner and victory over me. He's Jehovah Rapha, the Lord that healed me and take the sickness out of the midst of me. He's Jehovah Shalom, the Lord who gives you peace that passeth all understanding. He could have said, but he said, when you pray, say, oh, Father. Did he say God was Father? He want you to know him as a loving, caring, sharing. He's a Heavenly Father. He's a loving Father. He's not a mean, vindictive, hard, throwing banana peels down there so you can slip right into hell. That's not God. But some of us have a faulty view of God because we don't have a focused faith in the Father. So we end up with a faulty view of God. This is my third closing. Let me hit this and I close. If you have a now this is powerful, man. I should charge you for this. But I think we already did. If you have a preconception, if you have a preconception of something or someone, a preconception, and if that preconception is wrong, Dana. let's say, a people. In the philosophy of the world, and everyone has in the world, is philosophy. You don't get theology until you come into the Word. This book is theology. Theos is God. Ology is the study of God, or the study of God's Word. So before I got saved, I had philosophy. And in its smallest definition, philosophy is your opinion. Philosophy, now they have philosophically developed it into a thing that they say this is the philosophy of this, that, and the other, but it's really your opinion. It's really your opinion. I shared with you several weeks ago, if you didn't get that CD, make sure you get it. That's why Darwin tell you, it's called, look it up in your dictionary, I think it's still there. It's called Darwin's theory. Darwin said, this is a theory. And people have taken Darwin's theory and have made it dogma, which still is not doctrine. I think I'm getting a little too heavy up in here. See, dogma is still man's opinion about something. It's still, well, Bishop, Darwin's theory, yeah. So evolution, you don't believe in evolution. Who told you that? See, that's faith out of focus. God is an evolutionist. Not according to Darwin's theory. But evolution means it's always an unveiling and always an improving and always from faith to another level of faith. Just when you think you got it all, God takes you and show you something that you didn't have. He's constantly evolving. He's showing you. In other words, God is God. God could have made everything that he made in one day. All that it took was for God to say. And God said. Now, couldn't he had God said, number one, two, three, four, and just said, number one, let the light appear. Light appear. Number two, couldn't he? How long does it take for you to say that, Joe? Dr. Bunn, how long would God, it didn't say God constructed or had a construction company, and God says it's going to take us about 24 hours to get this thing done right here. No, God said, and that was it. The evening and the morning was the first day. And then the evening and the morning, God did some more stuff. And it wasn't because he was tired. It wasn't because God said, man, that was a heck of a workout today. He evolved, not according to Darwin's theory that we come from a tadpole or whatever he's saying, and then we become, and from there we come into a, you know, you come into a monkey. I know we act like one, but that's, we ain't talking about Darwin's theory of evolution. We're talking about God. It's constantly evolving stuff. And so if man is out of focus with man's dogma, your opinion. That's all you had before you had God's theology was philosophy. Well, this is what I think. And this is what I think. I don't believe God's like that. I don't believe God would do this. I don't believe God did. You haven't read the book. Are y'all gonna give me a few moments here? See, we come into the church with philosophy. And God counteracts that and says, I'm giving you theology. Now, the way you think is gonna have to match the way you believe. Meaning, I believe the book, but you're thinking something other than the book. So it's called faith out of focus, and it's a faulty view of God. And God's theology, I'm getting ready to close on, but his theology is, see, and this is what we learned in the world. We learned in the world, I'm right. Even when you're wrong, you still want to. Some people, it's hard for them to even admit I'm wrong about anything. Some people, why? Because if I admit I'm wrong, then the next thing is, why won't you say I'm sorry? But son, if we won't say I'm sorry to God, Valerie, you can forget about me saying I'm sorry to you. It was John F. Kennedy that said that our problem, now listen to this, and this is a good saying. I remember that so when John F. Kennedy said that, I was a little boy, I was saying, he says, our problem is man-made. So if we have man-made problems, then man can fix them. Now that's where he's wrong. Man made the problem, Adam did that. But God didn't put Adam out and say, you fix your own daggone problem. Get up out of here. God was the one, oh, I feel this. God was the one that said that I'm going to bring forth a deliverer. Man cannot save himself. Hallelujah. You can go to Barnes & Noble and buy all the help, wanted books that you want, glory to God. But until you look to Jesus Christ and allow Jesus to fix the problem in you, allow Jesus, who is the way. If you believe it, give God a praise. He's the way, the truth, and the life. And see, the problem is, God, many of us right now, we're looking for instructions. What's next? What do I do, God? You've messed up. What do I do, God? What do I do, God? You start off confessing your sins. What do I do, God? You're waiting for instructions, and God says, I can't give instructions unless I first give corrections. If I cannot correct you, I cannot instruct you. I'm not going to give you instructions if I cannot give you correction. And all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, reproof, folk, number three, correction, number four, instruction, where? In righteousness. And if she won't let me correct her, then that's why I can't instruct her. And you got people who come to church and the preacher is preaching his heart. That is the heart of God out to you. But you won't accept God's correction, so you leave without God's instruction. In other words, if God cannot reprove your paper, he cannot approve your paper. Some of us are waiting for approval and God can't reprove you. There is no approval. And so God is so merciful. God is so righteous. God is so good. But many of us, we have faith out of focus because we have a faulty view of God because we come in with this philosophy, which is really my opinion. A preconception. And if I have, and in the world, listen to me. In the world, it's about domination. One nation dominating another. One people dominating another. It's about being boss. It's about being, I'm the boss of this house. Yeah, you think you are. But anyway, it's about being the boss. It's about who's going to be the boss. Psalms, David says, why do the heathen rage and the people imagine this vain thing? And the people, the philosophy, they, why? And he goes on to say, because they say, I'm in charge. And this is the point that God is saying. If, whether me, with Valerie, if I'm trying to dominate. See, God said, well, he said we should have dominion, but he told you over the birds of the air. Now, I want to close. But he told you. He didn't just, see, some of us take it, it's out of focus. We got a faulty view of God. God said, I got dominion. Well, get control of yourself first. But we end up with, I got dominion. He says, over the birds of the air. Okay, is there anything else? Over the fowls of the air, over the cattle, over all the creeping things on the earth. So now if a person is a creep, maybe you got a point there. But I said, over every creeping thing on the earth. He didn't say you have dominion over the next person. Now watch this. If I have a preconception, even of people, meaning it comes from, listen, it comes from tradition, not from the word. And Jesus said, your tradition has made the word of none effect. Why? Because why? It's your tradition. This is the way. This is the way I was brought up. You was brought up as a sinner. Now, what else you want to talk about? If the tradition is not centered, if you would, in the word of God, then God is saying the truth of God's word. If I see women, if somehow I think women are less than man, if somehow I feel that a woman is a second-class citizen to me. If I feel that, then I'll treat her the way I see her, based upon my conception, which was a preconception, because on the street, I learned that women serve us. And if I see it that way, even though she's my wife, she's not equal with me. So I don't treat her with equality because I don't see her as my equal because of my preconception of her. So no, she shouldn't make the kind of money that I make. Not unless she's the only one working. I'm getting ready to close. See, you should have came to the 8 o'clock service. Now, somebody said, work. Theology and philosophy has to be married, where the way I think has to be based upon my belief. And where did you get your belief? From the book. And if my theology and philosophy is right, then the anthropology, which is man and woman, I see that right. And if my philosophy and my theology and my anthropology is right, then my sociology will be right. I feel like, yeah. Then socially, we won't have, because God has straightened it out. So if I don't start with God the way God sees, then I'm just left with philosophy the way I see. But it's not the way God sees. So I have a faulty view of God. Valerie and I, we went to preach. And we went to preach in this city. And when we got there to the airport, the pastor, last minute, this was our first time preaching there, and the last minute, something urgent came up, and he had to detour and go and take care of a particular situation. So he sent one of his associate ministers to pick us up, Pastor Westbrook. And I never will forget this. We get there, and the people were getting off the plane, deplaning, and people was hugging their loved ones or whoever they's waiting for. And Valerie and I, we walked right by the people that was picking us up. We walked right by them. I was looking for somebody to shake my hand and greet me and hug me. And I looked at the guy, and the guy was standing there, he and his wife, and he was looking. He was looking around, And I'm standing over there, and he's looking over there. And I'm looking around, he's looking around. Finally, nobody else was around but him and me. He looked at me, Pastor Bob. I looked at him, and he says, he looked at me, and he just shook his head. I never will forget it. He couldn't believe. He said, you wouldn't be Bishop Holcomb. He didn't say, hey, are you Bishop? He just couldn't believe. You wouldn't be Bishop Holcomb. I said, what's left of me? He said, man, listen, I listened to your tapes. He says, and man, you got a voice that I'm looking for a, and he was a big man. He said, I'm looking for a big, humongous man. And here little me standing, you know. And I never will forget it. I says, that's a faulty view. Because, Boykin, this is the problem. Who he was looking for, this is the problem, was there, but he did not exist. The one he was looking for, Boykin, he was there, but he did not exist. The one he was looking for, he had an image of him, a perception of him, that even though he was there, he couldn't see him. And he was there. Some of us, we have a perception of God, and if the perception is not in focus, then the view of what you have of God will affect your faith in how you believe God. And some people's faith has been hindered, has been haunted. Oh, I can't. God is him. And some people, I'm not passing the buck, but some people, they say, I don't even believe in God. And there's no way that's true. But what they don't believe in is the God that we say he is. He said, that can't be true. That can't be true. Then I'll choose not to believe there is a God. And that's not true, but they don't believe in the God that some have projected Jesus to be. So you end up with an atheist. Where when it gets right down to it, I know you believe because the devil believe. And the devil is the one that's trying to get you not to believe. And the devil believe in God. So there's no one that can legitimately say, I'm an atheist and I don't believe in God. No, you just need to get the right focus of the true and living God. And Jesus has come to give unto us the picture of who God is. And no one in this day and time have seen the picture of Jesus. Michelangelo can paint what he painted. But the Bible says the first commandment, don't make an image of him. Because if you paint a picture of God, and that's not his picture, then you have taken faith out of focus already. And God tell you, don't do that. Now, God describes himself in an anthropomorphous way, of anthropomorphism. Meaning he says, my arm is not too short. So wherever you are, God says, wherever you are, my arm is not too short. I can reach you.
You carry.
No, no, wherever you are, God says, my arm is not too short. He said, my hand is not weak. He said, David is a man after my heart. God is describing to us in an anthropomorphism, but God is saying, don't make a picture of me. Just remember that I'm everywhere. I don't go nowhere. I take you somewhere, but I'm already there because I'm everywhere. And God goes on and on and on, and you say, well, what in the world? No, what God is describing unto us, he said, you want to see how I am? Look at Jesus. And Jesus says to his disciples, when they said, Lord, show us the Father, show him to us. And Jesus says, how long have I been with you that when you see me, you see the Father? And Jesus was filled with compassion. He was filled with love, not hatred, but love. Filled with love to such a degree that the religious leaders said, we got to kill him because he's taken our power. And the sinners and the publicans was drawn to him. And they knew there was something authentic about this God that the Bible says that they would come and they would hear him and he would love them, forgive them, talk to them, bless them. And it says that the religious people says, the sinners call him their friend. I hope as we continue, next week we'll pick it up when I get back, with confession, saying who God is, saying who God says we are, saying what God says you can have, saying what God says you can do, and then stepping out by faith in doing it. Stand up and give God a praise. What a tough service today.
Please join me as we confess verses 13 through 15 of the 92nd Psalm. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. To show that the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him.